Hi friends, starting with the 10 Jan editorial, the first editorial is Oiling Cashless Wheels. This editorial is about the threat by the petroleum retailers to stop accepting the credit and debit card payments. Before looking on to the issue, let's look at the various initiatives taken by the government in order to increase the cashless transactions after the demonetization. So the public sector banks have been advised by the center to charge a maximum of rupees 100 a month as the POS, which is known as point of sale device rentals from small merchants, and the move has benefited around 6.5 lakh of the 15 lakh POS devices. And the government Now, coming to what is merchant discount rate, you know, as the banks provide payment services, the merchants have to give a payment to the bank for using the payment infrastructure set up by the bank, and this payment is known as merchant discount rate. So the government had waived the service tax on MDR surcharge from December 8th for card payments up to rupees 2000. And there was MDR, banks were asked not to charge MDR on all debit cards till 31st December 2016. And the public sector oil marketers were asked to offer 0.75% discount to the customers using non-cash means to tanker. The railways, public sector insurers and others have been asked to offer discounts or charge lower rates for cashless transactions. Now, looking onto the issue, so the government had asked the banks not to charge merchant discount rate on debit card only till 31st December 2016. Now what happened is that from 1st Jan, the bank started charging merchant discount rate on the debit card payments, and they're charging around up to 1% on the card payments, and this led to a protest by the fuel dealers. So following the protest, the petroleum minister said that neither the consumer nor the dealers, you know, would bear the MDR for fuel refills after Jan 13th, and he said stakeholders will absorb the cost. But the question is, who are the stakeholders? See, if the consumer is not paying and even the dealer is not paying, and how will the banks get their MDR? So that is the main question now. So now, looking at the various steps or measures taken by the government in relation to merchant discount rate, first is that cabinet had given the nod for rationalizing the MDR charges, and also an expert panel had been formed to recommend legislative and other changes in August. So the recommendations by the panel were, first is to moot the greater transparency in the fees for digital payments. And second is the private protection of the private data of the consumers. And third is a mechanism to ensure that they will not be, or the mechanism to ensure that the consumer will not be liable to pay for unauthorized transactions or system errors, and also creation of the new payment regulator. So to conclude, in order to build a confidence in cashless economy, people should have the clarity and consistency in policy along with a visible roadmap to secure their confidence. So we all know that the government has brought out lucky draws in order to encourage the cashless transactions from the consumers as well as the merchants. So you know, only lucky draws are not sufficient in order to bring the confidence among the consumers and merchants. So therefore, what is needed is a consistent policy by the government. Now, the next editorial, which is A Blow to Reformists in Iran. This editorial speaks about the death of the former president Ali Akbar Hashemi, who was a powerful cleric who was widely considered a leading moderate in Iran's polity. Now, his death will be a major blow to the reformists in the country. Now, let's look at the background of former president. He had a complex and long tenure as a political leader. He emerged as a revolutionary who participated in the overthrow of the Shah regime, and he headed parliament in the post-revolution, and also he has been elected as a president twice. You know, after he became the president, he built an economy which was devastated in the almost decade-long war against Iraq, and you know, he also promoted the liberal economic policy that moved Iran away from the statism, and also, you know, he had this realistic foreign policy which sought to protect the Iranian geopolitical interest and also to minimize the tensions with the West. But on a negative side, he was known as, he was like ruthless as an administrator, presiding over suppression of dissent by arresting and executing several prominent leaders and leftists. So once after he was out of power, he was seen as a powerful moderate cleric. But then, he enjoyed the support of the bazaar, which acted as a buffer in the war between the reformist and hardliners. Now let's see who are reformist and hardliners. Reformists are the one who sought to establish the rule of law and also better relation with the West, whereas hardliners, emphasized on the supremacy of the theocracy and conservative values flowing from the guardianship of clerics who led the revolution. The former president, he acted as a buffer between both of them. And also, he played a very important role in the signing of landmark nuclear deal between the P5 plus one countries and Iran. Now, the situation in Iran is like hardliners have shown little inclination to go back to the deal that restricts any weaponizing program by Iran. And given the former president's death and more volatile world over the rise of Donald Trump in US, suggests that there would be challenges to deal in the near future. Now moving on to the next editorial, which is the world at crossroads. The editorial speaks about how the world will be after in 2017. We have gone through similar editorials before also. Now this will be like just and I've picked a few important points and looking at them. So the writer says the policy outlook for 2007, it's not too promising. There'll be geopolitical risk and no improvement in the present unstable global order appears likely. And he also says that there'll be new terror patterns that will increase the lethality of the terror attacks, and also there'll be a lot of digital disruption and cyber threats. Now, coming to the economic outlook, it appears to be pessimistic with a global economy caught in low growth trap, and there will also be widening inequality and increasing unemployment. So, after a decade of economic lows, the prevailing sentiment in the marketplace will be uncertainty. So, there will be a lot of uncertainty in the marketplace given the low economic global growth. And also he says that in some ways 21st centuries have proved to be a disaster for the status quo West, which failed to recognize the implication of the shift in the economic power to the East, even as some countries of Asia turned into new engines of growth. So he's basically saying that there is the shift in the economic power which the West has failed to recognize. And Chinese President Xi Jinping was possibly one of the few world leaders to recognize the nature of the tectonic shift which is taking place. And he came up with the One Belt, One Road initiative, accompanied by the huge investment in infrastructure to connect China with Europe and the world. Now, coming to the terror attacks, there are a few important points which might be asked in PT regarding they might give the terrorist organization a name and they can ask you to match with the country. So now let's look into that. A sharp increase, the writer says that there will be sharp increase in the lone wolf and copycat terror attacks, and this will result in the increase in fatalities in 2007. The Russia now till now, which has not witnessed serious terror attacks for some time, could come. There might be a chances of Russia becoming vulnerable, and Southeast Asia may witness many more terror attacks following a call by Hizb ut-Tahrir to retaliate for the treatment meted out to Rohingya Muslims in Myanmar. And coming to North and East Africa, where outfits like Boko Haram and Al Shahab are now also the Al Qaeda in Islamic Maghreb have been on rampage during the past 2 years, will not see any respite in 2017. So these terror organizations are important and their countries. Okay, so this was a few important points from the editorial. Now moving on to the next editorial, respite not reconciliation. This speaks about the situation in the Syria and the peace talks. So now taking the present situation in Syria, the Syrian Arab army has now control over the Aleppo, which means that government once more is in charge of the main population centers in the country. And the opposition and armed forces are, they are still in control around the Damascus and in Idlib, and the Islamic State hold the northern city of Raqqa. These forces, they seem very disorganized, weakened logistically, and they disoriented. And now they don't have the support of the West, Gulf Arabs and Turkey. So what these fighters are doing is that they have moved to a great desperation in the violence. So they are moving into a path of violence, or some are surrendering also. Now, coming to the developments, the ceasefire was brokered on December 30th, and the peace talks will begin on January 23rd in Astana, which is in Kazakhstan. This peace talks will include countries Iran, Russia, Syrian government, sections of the Syrian opposition, Turkey, and the United Nations. But United States and Europeans will not participate. Now, looking at the little the background, for the past 5 years, the main slogan from the Syrian opposition, the Gulf Arab, Turkey, and Western allies were that the Syrian president Bashar al-Assad must go. So, given the strong Syrian army, unlike the Libyan army, which was easily defeated by the West, the Western countries realized that for the fall of Syrian president Bashar al-Assad, the major military intervention is required. But there was no support for Western military intervention because given the experience in Iraq, and there was no domestic support in the Western countries for the for the use of troops in fighting the Syria. And there was not much interest in the UN intervention also, given its the experience in about the regime change in Libya and its disastrous consequences after that. So the people were opposed for the UN intervention too. So now the question is, without direct Western military intervention and without UN intervention, what did the Western countries do? The Western countries followed an indirect tactics. They started supporting the rebels by providing them with the arms, and they also supported various extremist groups like Al-Qaeda. And also the Turkey opened its border for the Islamic State in order to fight the Syrian government. So, given this indirect support by the Western countries to the rebels, what did Syrian president do is that he turned to Iran and Russia for help. So, thus, Russia started intervening in the Syria from September 2014, thus ending the any possibility of regime change in Syria. Now, let's talk about the Turkish shift. First, the Turkey supported the rebels in Syria, and they also opened their borders for the IS to fight against the Bashar al-Assad regime. Now, what happened is that IS, they started going against Turkey itself, given the number of bomb attacks, and also the Turkey cancelled the ceasefire agreement with the Kurdish people, and they opened war against them, and this led to a disastrous effect on the Turkey itself. So now what Turkey did was it sought a rapprochement with Russia for economic and political reasons. This new alignment of Turkey meant that border along the Turkey, which was used to supply the rebels, with the arms, will be closed. So this was he very helpful for the success of the Syrian army in Aleppo. Now, taking a situation like what might happen after the peace talks. Now, the question is, will the violence decrease after the peace talks between the few countries? The writer says there might be an increase in the number of violence, given the attacks in Jordan, Saudi Arabia, and Turkey, because that is the only way where the rebels and the Islamic State will be left with. And come taking the experience from the Iraq, which was accustomed to violence since the illegal US invasion in 2003, saw over 6,000 civilians killed last year. It's often strategically targeted against Shia neighborhoods and religious places in order to deepen the trough of sectarianism. So taking the experience from Iraq, even after the US invasion, it saw the increase in the number of attacks on the civilians. So therefore, the writer says the same thing might repeat in Syria too. Now, moving on to the next editorial, which is A Rights Bill Gone Wrong. This speaks about the Transgender Persons Protection of Rights Bill 2016. Now, looking at the various concerns, the first concern is that there is no provision for courts or the special commissions for the transgenders. And second is the problem in the definition of transgenders. And third is about the reservation. Fourth is that the bill is not based on right-based approach. And fifth is on the impact on the existing laws. And sixth speaks about Section 377. Now let's look into all the concerns one by one. So now coming to the background, on April 2014, the Supreme Court delivered the landmark judgment of Nalsa versus Union of India, which affirmed the fundamental rights of transgender persons. The court gave a series of directives to the government to institute welfare measures for transgender persons. And it also directed that expert committee report prepared by the Ministry of Social Justice and Empowerment be implemented. In December 2014, a private member of the Rajya Sabha introduced a bill called Transgender Persons Bill 2014, which was passed by the Rajya Sabha, but it never made to the Lok Sabha. Instead, you know, the government decided to come with its own bill, which is called the Rights of Transgender Persons Bill 2015. And this bill was largely based on the 2014 bill, but it did away with the provisions of the transgender rights courts and the national state commissions, which was the first concern. So even the 2016 bill doesn't have the provision for the courts and the national and state commissions. Issue, which is definition of transgender. The definition of the transgender person in the bill is similar to the definition of intersex, which has been found in the Australian Sex Discrimination Amendment Act. And the expert committee, you know, report clearly explains the difference between transgender and intersex identities. And the 2000 bill, you know, which granted it granted a transgender person the right to identify as either man, woman, or transgender. So there's need to change the definition of a transgender persons in the bill. Now moving on to the reservation, another problem was the absence of provision on reservation, which is contrary or against the Nalsa judgment and the 2000 and 2015 bills, which directed the reservation for transgender persons. And next concern is that the bill does not encapsulate the right-based approach. The Nalsa judgment recognized the fundamental rights of the transgender persons in relation to the Articles 14, 19 and 21 of the Constitution. The present bill, though it uses the words rights in its title, it deviates from the right-based approach and leaves the transgender persons at the mercy of benevolent state. And this is very much puzzling, given that, you know, the recent laws like the Right of Persons with Disabilities Act and the Mental Health Care Bill, they all recognize the rights of the stakeholder, whereas the present bill does not. And the next issue is that the present bill is silent on its impact on the operation of existing laws. Now, the most laws, including the marriage, adoption and succession, continue to be based on the binary of male and female. And even the criminal laws, especially those dealing with the sexual offences, also continue to be gendered. And, you know, given this scenario, it remains a significant barrier to access to the legal justice for the transgender person. So the law which recognizes just the two genders, that is male and female, has led to the denial of access to the legal justice for the transgender persons. You know, taking the examples worldwide, jurisdictions like UK, Ireland, Argentina and Malta, they have legislated on the transgender rights and they clarify in their laws the impact gender change will have on existing legal institutions that are inaccessible to the persons with the non-conforming genders. And the Nalsa judgment too recognized the need for making civil rights accessible to the transgender persons. But the present bill fails to take this into account. Now, coming to the Section 377, the Section 377 has been frequently used to harass the transgender persons, specifically the transgender women. You know, the Section 377, it criminalizes the all sex that is not between the people of opposite genders. But if you want to recognize the transgender rights, it is more than the opposite genders of male and female. We have to embrace the rights of persons with non-conforming genders, and while criminalizing the persons with non-conforming sexual orientation is still absurd. So the writer speaks about the, you know, changes in the Section 377 that has to be brought out by the government. Because as we know, you know, the court has said that any changes to be brought out in Section 377 lies with the government. So now it all rests with the government in order to bring these changes in Section 377, which recognizes the rights of the transgender persons. So that's it for today's editorial. If you found this editorial useful, please like and subscribe to my channel and also give me your feedback. Thanks.